Welcome back, everyone. Our next session gives us a view of the future of effective learning management systems. How can organizations make LMS effective in integrating with the user's workflow or improve it to give the best results in a changing and challenging environment? And to present this session, we have with us Arun Subramaniam, co-founder and Paradigm Performance Solutions. Arun has been associated with NParadigm for more than 5 years. Welcome, Arun. We are looking forward to a great and engaging session. And over to you. Thank you so much.
So thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Okay, so good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to wherever all of you are from. This is Arun here from NParadigm. And what we're going to talk here is about the future of effective LMS. So I think all of us are familiar with the concept of LMS, I presume, learning management systems. They've been around for quite a while. They've taken different forms and shapes over the last few years, some that have quite worked, some that have not. So what we're going to talk about is where we see the future of effective LMS going in. And again, this is not about a wish list of what we think should work or what we think could work. We're essentially going to talk about what we have observed over the past 2 or 3 years and how we see it working in the future starting today. So we're going to share with you, some examples of what we have done to go in that path and what we have seen work and what we have seen not work. And again, this is not a definitive statement to make where you say, you know what, this is where LMS would be, because that's predicting the future, which nobody can. But what we're going to make is to do is to make an honest attempt in talking about which direction the future of LMS is taking. And that's what this presentation or this sharing of view is going to be all about. Okay. So a quick introduction. We're from NParadigm. We do a lot of business simulation learning programs, and we leverage simulations with interlaced with artificial intelligence and a lot of business logic to drive learning. And all our programs are highly customized, made very relevant to the user's business context. And the whole idea is that these simulation programs should lead to some real world impact. So the way we work on these simulations is also that, the simulations do not really drive learning. It's the concepts and ideas that really drive the learning as, we keep moving around. So for us, the concept sessions that come out of these simulations is what really work. And we've been doing this for about 8 years now. We work with over 450 companies, and that's worked out quite well. But now, what does this have to do with LMS? We are a learning company, but we also do some bit of work with the LMS. So before we go ahead, we'll talk about why we think we are qualified to talk about this. So you talk about NParadigm. We have over 120,000 users who use our learning systems, learning platforms. And our daily usage rate is about 45%, weekly usage rate is about 85%. And more importantly, the consumption rates that we have experienced for some of our, for our programs, net is about 89-90%, which I'm sure most of us would agree is quite high. And again, just to keep in mind, this consumption rate is with an audience where the consumption is not mandatory. So I'm sure there are a lot of courses where, participants are expected to, complete their courses, that's part of their performance management, etc. So here, these numbers reflect people who do it out of their own free will. So this is our credentials, and now we'll talk about where we started off, and to give you an example of where these numbers really stand. So all of you know, Facebook on mobile is a very, very addictive, application. And if you look at the usage rate of Facebook, so statistics say that about 50% of users of Facebook on mobile come back to the app every day, and about 73% of them come back to the app at least once a week, and that's quite high rate of consumption. But if you look at what NParadigm's users do, so we have about 45% of users coming to us every day, and we have about 85% of users coming to us at least once a week, and to us this is a big deal. So question is, how did we come here, and how do we say this is a direction in which the future goes? So if you were to look at this, we'll talk about three things that really kick-started the whole discussion. If you remember, like I said, initially I said we were a learning company. So we did a lot of learning interventions primarily with senior leaders. So most of our work till about 3-4 years used to be with CEOs and CXOs and head of sales. So when we worked with them, they really liked the work we did. And they said, you know what, I find what you guys do interesting, but can you help me skill up my sales force? because that was a problem that persisted across multiple organizations, multiple sectors. And this is a common request that we got from head of HRs, head of L&Ds, and more importantly, the business heads and sales heads. So we took this on as a new challenge, and we went about understanding what really is happening, because you can't have such a big sales force and say that they're not skilled enough. Of course, they are skilled. It's not to say that they're bad. So when we looked at this, we said there are three key aspects to any learning. So one is the kind of content that you have. The second one is how you're going to deliver this. And third thing is how people are going to consume it. So this works both in a classroom context as well as away from the classroom context, and or I would call it a distance learning or self-learning concept. And if you look at the content, we didn't find too many issues with our clients. So for all the people who came to us, we looked at what content they have. They had amazing PPTs, videos, learning modules. Everything looked quite good, quite good, jazzy, very presentable. People really liked what they saw. Next part was delivery. So next question that we had was, hey, you have all this amazing content. How are you going to deliver it to people? Because when you talk specifically of salespeople, you're talking about an audience who is on the road a lot of time, people who are what we would call deskless workers. And it's difficult to keep in touch with them. So how do you do it? And most organizations also had an LMS in place, which worked quite well, which had all the features. But when we looked at the third part in terms of how this information is being consumed, so that's where we had a small issue where we saw that the consumption wasn't too great. So we realized that people had questions, the consumption wasn't really happening. And this is where we started deep diving, saying, hey, if content is available, if the delivery is good and the consumption is not happening, that means there is a certain gap between the delivery and the consumption part. Clearly, there is no handshake that's happening between delivery and consumption. So we went and figured, we tried to figure out what was working in both the delivery and consumption. So we said the gap could either be in the delivery mechanism, where the delivery mechanism wasn't effective, or the gap would be at a consumption level where people weren't really ready to consume. So we deep dived into this. When you look at the delivery mechanism, we said, we saw LMSs, and LMSs had a lot of functions. You had user-friendly navigation, responsive design. You could use it on a mobile, you could use it on a desktop. They were driven tight to your KPIs. You had assessments, you had rewards, people had analytics. So all of this, anything that you really wanted, it was there. So LMS had evolved into a very complex and comprehensive system, and everything was quite good. So we said there seems to be no issue with the delivery system. So what happens to consumption in that case? But when you talk to customers, we realized that adoption rates were as low as 15%. Retention was quite low in terms of what people retained after they went through certain courses. And finally, it was very difficult to track the impact. So what did you learn? How are you really going to track how people are implementing it, and how you're going to tie the loop, close the loop? So that was an issue that we had. And some issues that really cropped up repeatedly from the consumption side was one, people generally had very low self-drive to learn. So not many people were interested in going all out and saying, I really need to learn something. So that was something that never really came up. The second one was the work and performance part, performance pressure. So people, had, especially in a sales force, they had a lot of performance pressure. You had weekly reviews, you had daily reviews. And one of the other things that we realized was, especially from seasoned sales professionals, was they said, about 5 years back, I used to have weekly meetings. And at the end of the day, at the end of the week, we'd get to our office. And in case I didn't meet my numbers or I didn't do my work, boss would scream at me for half an hour. I just had to put my head down in shame and then walk out, and that was it. And then I didn't have to worry about it for the next 1 week. But today, in the time of age of WhatsApp, I'm being followed consistently. So at the beginning of the day, my boss wants to know what my day's plan is. In the afternoon, he wants a quick update. And in the evening, again, I get a message asking what's happened to my numbers, what's happened to my meeting status. And if I don't respond to them on time, I get another message at 9 in the night saying, hey, I saw 2 double ticks with blue. What happened? So people were being followed. Whether they like it or not, we have moved to the WhatsApp era where the communication is quick. So under this kind of performance pressure, our salespeople weren't really looking at doing something which didn't help them in selling. So people really liked to say that they wanted to learn, but to them, performance was better. And a lot of people fairly said, I'm being measured on my performance. I'm not being measured on what I learned. So please bugger off. So that's something that really happened. And even for those people who were ready to learn, the third issue that came up was really that the systems were quite cumbersome. For example, where do you go and find the relevant material to read? How do you access this? And we really saw that there were high dropout rates. When I say dropout rate, it's from the time you think that you want to really learn something to the time you reach a place where you can start learning. You know, that process was quite cumbersome and a lot of people dropped in. For example, let's say you decide at last to say, you know what, I want to learn. So you will have to get your laptop out. You will have to remember the URL for your learning system. Once you go in, it will ask for a separate user ID password, which may or may not be the same as your laptop's user ID password. Once you hit forget password, you log in, then you will have to figure out which course to take because it's not very clear. So people had to go through, I think, 11 or 12 different stages or 11 or 12 clicks to reach the content that they had to start with. So this dissuaded a lot of people from consuming the information that was there. And finally, you have your infrastructure complaints. For example, I told you, people would open up their laptops, then they would realize they have no internet connectivity. They don't have battery in the laptop. So I could make a presentation, I'm on the road, or I could do this learning. Which am I going to prioritize? I would, of course, prioritize my work. So there are a lot of these constraints that came up, when we spoke to people in terms of understanding why, audience were not really consuming some of this information. So we took these two issues that we saw. One is in terms of the delivery system. Other is in terms of consumption. And we went to the drawing board and we said we are going to do some research to figure out how we can solve it. So we spent 6 months on the field. We interacted with more than 300 salespeople, went on calls with them, sat with them through their sales process. And we came up with some learning. We realized that accessibility was something which was really, really important. Second part was people have moved forward from learning for the sake of learning. They said, help me do my work. So enable me to do my work. Do not teach me on how to do it. So the learning had to be much more closely integrated with what they were doing. And, people wanted the information just in time. So, the gratification, the delayed gratification that was once prevalent with the earlier generation never really worked in here. The people said, I want to learn something. I want to use it immediately. I don't want to learn something. Keep it. And one fine day use it, that didn't really work. And that was not the attitude that a lot of, users or people on the field displayed. So our focus was, we said we'll build an LMS, which is mobile first, which has some offline content, which gives you highly relevant data and which gives you dynamic daily updates. So we said our focus is going to be on all this. And we built something called Smart Skin, so which is our mobile first LMS. And we said it's going to be fully customized learning platform. But then another question that we had in our mind when building this was, hey, but is this going to be yet another LMS? Because, there's no dearth of LMSs out there in the world. There are LMSs which promise anything, everything. Some of them deliver, some of them don't. So question is, how are we going to be different? And more importantly, are we achieving what we started off to achieve, which is to ensure that people actually consume the content that was already available. So we said the platform needed to be validated by real users. So we went to a lot of our corporate clients to figure out if they would want to try it. But at that point of time, our corporate clients were a little skeptical about trying an LMS, which were close to the job, etc. They're entrepreneurs at heart. So in case they buy something, if they pay for something, that means it has value. And they're also salespeople by profession, which means if they are able to use it, that means salespeople are using our LMS and they're doing it. So we kind of went ahead and we said that's the proof of the pudding. If people pay, then we have got this. If users pay, we have got this, right? So we started off with the takeoff was slow. We had 30,000 installs in the first few months. Adoption rates were studied at 50 to 60. But then we really knew we could do better. So we weren't really happy with the 50 to 60% adoption rates. So we went back to the drawing board and we realized that there were quite a bit of dropouts during registration. People did not use it after installing it in the first instance. And even features and content that was highly, highly relevant to them, were not really accessed because people wouldn't go beyond. The drawing board, we added a lot of analytics to this. So we captured 2,000 actions or 2,000 clicks. So we could know who clicked where, what happened, how much time did they spend. So we did a lot of this. We tracked more than a million data points every day. And we had 12 major updates getting out in the first 6 months. And this was something that users like. And so some of the things that we did was to streamline registration through OTP. So we removed the hassle of requiring a username, password, etc. Because we said once we have the information available with us, the user need not re-enter the information. So we said we'll not collect a lot of data. We had push notifications, relevant tools were highlighted. So we did a lot of the stuff to get this LMS out and running. And if you really see how do people like this, we had a resounding success. So we had more than 100,000 users downloading this. The rating was about 4.5 on 5. And for insurance sales, this was the highest of any insurance sales related LMS app that was available in the market. And the retention was quite high. People kept coming back. So this became a huge success. So based on this, we also went to a lot of big customers. The adoption was quite high. So we worked with customers like Axis Bank, HDFC Bank, NIT Technologies, Bajaj. So these are big financial service IT companies in India who use it for their Salesforce, for people in sales to learn and apply during their sales. So this is something that we did. So coming back to another case, we did, we work with this organization called Bajaj FinServ, where, we're deploying this for over 3,000 users spread across 120 cities. And the completion rate for all the courses that go out on this LMS is about 91%, which means 91% of people, 91% of people have completed all the modules. And mind you, this is for a course which is not mandatory, because we've also had cases where some of our clients have come back to us saying, we have a completion rate of 40 to 50% for our mandatory courses. So this is stuff that we have done. And what we realized is we could use this for a lot of applications, sales, operation, HR, managing at self levels. We're working with people, on a manufacturing plant to drive this. We're using it for policy adoption. So the application areas are aplenty. And that's something that we did. So when we really want to summarize what the key to success really is, we say there are four key things. One is, does your LMS fit into the workflow of employees? So is that learning that enables performance in high work situations? If yes, we found that people would really adopt it. If not, people are not going to really use it, because the learning and the application, the cycle between learning and application has really shortened of late. And we realize that people are not ready to wait, learn and implement. Like we said, there's no delayed gratification that is working out there. The second part is there easy accessibility? So question is, I have this one quick thought saying, I need to learn something. Somebody told me something, so I just want to see what this is. So question is, are we making it easy for people to access their learning? So we will also have to realize that today most people are using a lot of, so mobile phones have become, the devices of first access. So most of people's time are spent on mobile phones, not on laptops or desktops as on today. So question is, how do you make it accessible for them? And how do you ensure that they don't have to worry about other constraints, like, checking for internet, is this already downloaded? Or what should I do? What am I going to learn today? So can you make it easily accessible? That you say on one click, whatever they have to learn is presented right onto them. So you make it much easier and interactive. So that is the second part. The third part is the right content at the right time. So this has two parts. One is, are you presenting the content at all? Does your platform allow you to tell people what they would require? Are you able to preempt what they need? The second part is this content relevant to them? Because today, like we said, it goes back to the first part. Does it apply to what they are doing? So that means this has to be the right content, which is very relevant at the right time. And what we also realized is the gamification part is also something that drives people. So you'd have smart triggers, you would have immersive gaming, you will have leaderboards and dashboards. But what we also see is this part is a little overemphasized. So we know a lot of a lot of our customers who've taken up gamified modules, gamified learning modules, and mind you, we are also people who offer that. But the fact is, gamification does not really solve the problem, because after some time, you're trying to force fit the gamification on people. So the gamification is something that really work if you have the first three points in place, which is does it fit with their workflow, is it accessible to them, and is it the right content for them. Once you have all that in place, the gamification can be used as a further push. And today, like I said, gamification is probably something that is overused, and people expect gamification to work on its own, which rarely does. Okay. So in some four parts, one, can we have utility to drive development? Can we enable performance in work situations? Can we achieve relevance? And how do we use gamification to do this? So these are four things that we learned. We say any LMS that is built has to get these things in the center of what they're doing. But the problem we see is, you know, we've seen this, we've applied this, and we've really seen this work. And that's what our numbers say. And our clients are very happy with what we do. But the problem that I see that still persists is people are still talking about a learning management system. And, we keep talking about customer centricity all around. The problem I see is, customer centricity works. In that case, you should not talk about learning management system. You should technically talk about what you call a learning consumption system. So the very fact that because you call it a learning management system, the customer of the learning management system suddenly becomes is someone who's sitting in the corporate office, someone who's part of the learning team. And a lot of tools and utilities are geared towards making it easy for, the person who manages the whole learning process, which is, your head of L&D or your head of HR business partner, etc. But in the meantime, the consumer or the user is slightly left behind or relegated. And this is a typical, user versus buyer problem. A lot of times your user is not the buyer. And in most LMS sales that go in, your user is somebody who's sitting in the office, who's on the field, who's out on the plant, who's out servicing. But then your buyer is somebody who sits in the corporate office, who's managing all this effectively. So maybe if we start calling this a learning consumption system, then everybody will start looking at what we're going to do to gear the consumption of information that's available. Because there's a lot of information out there. There's no dearth of information. But the question is, how do you make it easy for people to consume this? So this is our submission where, and this is the way we work, where we look at all our systems as learning consumption systems and not learning management systems. And we look at this as customer first, and that's how we see LMS is moving forward, where what we see is where, the content is available, and moving forward, the learning systems would be democratized, where participants would choose the learning system of their liking. So they'll say, content is going to be separate, the consumption system is going to be separate, just like, how you have, you have mail systems, you have a Gmail, you have a Yahoo, but then you can choose to use a Microsoft Outlook, you can choose to use a Thunderbird, Apple Mail, etc., etc. So on one side, you have the content, the other side, you can choose to decide on how you plan to see and use this information. So we see LMS is moving that way, and we see that as the future, because, the competencies required to do all this are also different. Today, a lot of companies who make LMSs also make the content, and they also do the distribution, and moving forward, we see this spreading out. So there'll be one side which focuses on ensuring that users use it, and there'll be another side which focuses on ensuring that the right content is developed, and there's going to be a handshake in between. So that's something that we really see as the future of LMS, and that's something that we have observed and learned over the past 2.5 years with a lot of customers in India. So to give the context, I think that's very important. And we think if it works in India, which is a very diverse market, where people speak about 100 plus languages, you have like 20 official languages, some areas where internet connectivity is good, penetration is high, some where it is not. There's a strong divide between the urban, urban audience and the rural audience. So we've been able to crack this system moving forward. And we think that if this can work in India, this approach can work in India, we see this approach working elsewhere in the world as well. So this is where we end this. Thank you. And I hope you got some insights on, what we think the future of LMS is, what we have done to do that. So this is what we are going to do as an organization, and I hope you're able to take some insights and apply it in your learning systems. Yeah.
Thank you, Arun. Thank you so much. We still have a couple of minutes, and I'd like to take that opportunity to share two questions that have come, and rest of the questions can be definitely taken up in the networking zone. So our first question from one of our viewers is, are there any use cases of this LMS being used outside of India as well?
So no, right now, I think it's Captain Shantanu had asked this. No, Captain Shantanu, we don't have use cases of this being used outside of India, but we are in the process of deploying it for some of our customers abroad. So maybe you know, next time we talk, I would have a use case which I can present to you.
Great, great. Our next question is, in future world, respective line managers contribute more towards building the content and structure. That's the question.
Yes, so I think the relevant content comes in there because the line managers are the best equipped to give you the right content. Because when you talk about what has to be done, it has to come from what the role demands. And it can't come from somebody who's sitting on the top. I mean, no offense to people who sit on the top. They have been there, done that. But, you know, when they were in the position of somebody who is, you know, fairly junior, that would have been about 10, 15 years ago. And a lot of things have changed. So one part is this has to come in from line managers. This has to be relevant. And this has to be updated quite frequently, because what the line manager says today might become completely irrelevant, 2 years down the line, because your customers are changing, your market is changing, your constraints of business are changing. So we'll also have to keep this updated. So I hope that answered Mr. Anonymous or Ms. Anonymous. Yeah.
I'm sure, and I can definitely see one more question that has popped up, Arun. And before we sign off, let's definitely address this question. How is OTP kind of access economical compared to license-based access?
See, OTP is not, so in terms of economy, it doesn't cost much. For example, in India, it costs about 10 paisa to send out an SMS, OTP-based authentication, which is one-time password-based, which is send to your mobile number. So in terms of economy, even if you have to send an SMS to a number which is based on the US or the European Union, you're talking about not more than 10 to 20 cents. So it's 20 euro cents, a message, which is not very expensive. In terms of license-based access, the problem is going to be that, how are you going to have the license-based access? So in this case, even though we authenticated on OTP, there is still a license-based access on the backend, which means every day I'm going to check if your license is still active. So when we deploy for organizations, this is a security concern, especially when you're talking about banks and financial service organizations. Every day the system authenticates if the employee is still on rolls. And if the employee is off rolls, the access is disconnected. If the employee doesn't come online for more than 10 days, the access is disconnected. So we have checks and measures to do that. But it's just that the way the license is accessed is through OTP and not through entering a license key or username, email ID, password. Because the objective also is everybody remembers their mobile numbers. So we say just enter what you already know. You don't have to look at what somebody gives you at some other point of time.
Super. Thank you so much. There are many more questions that have come. But Arun, unfortunately, we'll have to take these questions in the networking zone. So I'll request all the viewers and people who've been asking these questions to kindly move to the networking zone for more questions. Thank you so much, Arun. You've been the entire journey has been beautiful. Thank you so much for sharing all this information with us. And before we move on, let me share the secret code for this session. So the secret code for this session is hashtag learnman12. So that's hashtag LEARNMAN 12, numeric 12. So please, let's all move to the networking zone. Do visit our partner and exhibitor booths to learn more about what's happening. Of course, Arun will also be joining all of us there. The next session would begin in the next 20 minutes, and it would be on future of work, preparing your business for the gig economy. Till then, happy learning, and thank you, Arun, for your time.
Thank you, Ruby, and Pratima and Captain Shantanu, I'm going to get back to your questions in a minute's time. Thanks.
Absolutely. Thank you.